fantastic event, and thank you, Michelle, for that very kind introduction. So I'm going to talk today about sensitive periods of brain, cognitive, and social development in adolescence, but I'm going to start with a really quick video, which actually has nothing to do with adolescence, but you'll like it. Okay, so in this video, you're going to see a toddler who is brought to a lab in Germany by his parent, and the parent is given no instructions. They're in the waiting room, and they're videoed secretly. And look at the eye contact at the end. Like, duh, that's how you put it in. So those videos, and there are many of them published on the Science website by Tomasello and colleagues who published this paper, was taken as evidence that even at a really young age, these toddlers are about 18 months, they're able to read the intentions of other people. In this case, the adult who couldn't put his books inside the cupboard because his hands were full, but that was what he intended to do, which was what elicited that spontaneous helping behavior that you saw in the young child. Okay, so that there's a whole history of research on social processing in young children. That research has been going on since the 1960s, 1970s, and it wasn't until much more recently, in the last, say, 25 years, that experimental psychologists and cognitive neuroscientists became interested in social processing and social cognition in adolescence. So that is what I'm going to talk about today, adolescence. We define adolescence as the period of life between 10 and 24 years. So it's a very extended period of development, and it's a unique period of biological, psychological, and social development. Now, when you think about adolescence, you might think about behaviors that we typically associate with this age group, things like taking risks and acting impulsively and being influenced by friends. And you might think that those behaviors are a recent phenomenon in this age group, but there you would be wrong, because if you look at historical descriptions of adolescence, you see striking similarities with the way we typically describe this age group today. So I'm going to show you a few examples of those. So this first example comes from Shakespeare. Shakespeare wrote a lot about adolescence. There were many teenagers in his plays. In this play, The Winter's Tale, he says this about young people. He says, "I would there were no age between 10 and 3 and 20, or that youth would sleep out the rest, for there is nothing in the between but getting wenches with child, wronging the ancient tree, stealing, fighting." He was very negative about adolescence, as were the ancient Greeks. So go back even further than that, over 2,000 years ago, to ancient Greeks like Socrates. He wrote a lot about youth, and he was equally negative about young people. He said things like, they have bad manners, they show contempt for authority, they show disrespect for elders, and they love chatter in the place of exercise. Aristotle as well wrote a lot about youth, saying things like, they're passionate, irascible, apt to be carried away by their impulses. This is the age when people are most devoted to their friends. And that I've highlighted that sentence because that is the theme of this talk today. How friends become so much more important in adolescence compared with before adolescence or even afterwards. Adolescence is a period of life when we're developing a sense of who we are, a sense of self, and particularly a sense of social self. That is how other people see us. Other people's views of us become more and more important, and we become more influenced by other people, particularly our peers and our friends in adolescence. So this has been studied a lot in the context of risk-taking. Many labs around the world study risk-taking in adolescence, and that's probably because we really worry about the risks that some adolescents take. And there is a reason to be worried. If you look at the leading cause of mortality across the lifespan, you find the leading cause of mortality in people aged 10 to 24 is accidents, mostly caused by risk-taking. And that's not true at any other period of life. But it's not as simple as all adolescents take risks. First of all, some adolescents are very risk-averse, so there's lots of individual differences. Secondly, a certain amount of risk-taking is a really good thing. We learn through trial and error. We learn about our environments by taking the risk of exploring them. And finally, the context of risk-taking seems to matter in adolescence, perhaps more so than at other ages. And we know that adolescents are much more likely to take risks when they're with their friends. Now, there's a lot of research demonstrating that, both in the lab and from real-life data, like epidemiological data, data from car insurance companies, and data like the graph I'm just about to show you. So this is from the American Automobile Association Foundation. And what this graph shows is the percentage increase in fatal car accidents when young drivers, so the driver of the car is under the age of 21, drive with passengers in the car with them versus no passengers. What you can see is that taking one passenger in the car increases the risk of a fatal car accident by about 40%, and the risk increases exponentially with each additional passenger in the car. That's also what the lab-based research shows, and it has been incorporated into policy. So in the UK, this is a screenshot from the RAC in the UK. In the UK, the government is considering banning young drivers who've recently passed their test from giving friends lifts, and that is already policy in some countries like Canada and Australia. Now, it's not just humans whose behavior is changed by the social environment. That also happens in animals. So all species of animal go through a period of life between puberty and adulthood, and you can call that period adolescence. And they are studied, animals are studied during their adolescent period, their brains and their behavior are studied. The most common animal to be studied is the mouse or the rat, so rodents. They go through about 35 days of adolescence. And in those first 35 days, you can see all sorts of changes in behavior, heightened risk-taking, more exploration of the environment, very big changes in social behavior. And it was recently shown that adolescent mice drink more alcohol when they're with other mice, but that's not true for adult mice. So you can see that here in this graph. This shows the time they spend drinking alcohol, which equates to the amount of alcohol drunk. When they're on their own in a cage, the adolescent mice drink around the same amount of alcohol as the adult mice. But when they're put with their cage mates, that significantly increases the amount of alcohol the adolescent mice drink, but it has no effect on the amount of alcohol the adult mice drink. Okay, I'm now going to get you to do a little 30-second experiment. What I want you to do, this side of the room, I want you to stay completely silent and just think about this question on your own. This side of the room, all of you, you can get together in little groups and discuss this question, okay? So you're silently thinking about it. You're discussing with other people around you. The question is, that hotel, how many rooms does it contain? Don't Google it. And if you know it, don't shout it out. But just think about it. Try and work it out from basic principles. And you guys discuss in groups of like three or four. You've got 30 seconds. Okay, so what I want you to do is take a guess. So can anyone guess? You don't have to get it completely right, but what number did you come up with, approximately? Anyone on this side? Yeah?
2,000,
any down here?
Yeah.
3,200. 5,000.
Any others from over here?
Four. 480. Okay, that experiment has completely failed. The correct number is 2,561, which actually was the closest person to get that number was over on this side. what I wanted to show you is how when you collaborate with other people, that leads to more accurate answers and better performance, but it didn't work here. The other thing I wanted to illustrate is that it feels very different, doesn't it, when you're on your own thinking about something versus when you're chatting to other people, because we're all influenced by each other. And, you know, there might have been an expert in your group who maybe worked at that hotel, who might have known more about it. There might be someone who is knowledgeable about facts about hotels around the world or something like that. So we can be particularly influenced by certain people. That kind of social influence is exactly what we study. And I'm going to give you an example of that from a study we did a few years ago led by my former postdoc, Lisa Null. So in this study, she was looking at social influence on risk perception, and she studied 563 participants aged between 8 and 59 years. And it's a very straightforward experiment, which I'll just talk you through. Okay, so you're presented on a laptop with a scenario like this, which carries a moderate risk. So crossing a street on a red light, I don't think anyone in Singapore does that, but in the UK people do that a lot and it's a bit risky. And other scenarios are things like cycling without a helmet or driving without a seatbelt. And then you're asked to rate how risky you think that scenario is on a sliding scale using a computer mouse. And then you're told, all the teenagers who've taken part in this experiment so far, this is how risky they rated that same scenario. Now, in fact, that's a cover story. This isn't really a risk rating from other teenagers. It's randomly generated by the computer. But the participants think that's the average risk rating from teenagers. And in another condition, they think the average risk rating comes from, or the provided rating comes from adults. And then they're asked to rate the same scenario again. And what we're interested in is how much people change their ratings from time one to time two. Are they influenced by the provided rating? And our kind of new question in this study and a series of studies we did is, are people more influenced by adults than they are by teenagers? So our hypothesis was, well, if you're going to be influenced, you're probably more likely to be influenced by adults than by teenagers. So I'm going to show you the results now of that particular study. Okay, down here we have the five age groups that we tested: children aged 8 to 11, young adults aged 12 to 14, this is the age in years here, mid-adolescents, young adults, and adults, 26 and over. And this is the difference in how much they were influenced by teenagers versus by adults. Remember, our hypothesis was that people would be more influenced by adults than by teenagers. And if that's true, then the bar will be below the zero line. And that was the case for the children and the two adult groups. The adolescents behaved somewhat differently. So the mid-adolescents were in the middle. They were equally influenced by adults as by teenagers. And the young adolescents showed the opposite effect. They were more influenced by teenagers than by adults. So young adolescents' risk perception is influenced more by other teenagers, by people their own age, than by adults. And we replicated that in two different groups of participants here. So we think it's a pretty robust effect. So what does that mean for everyday adolescent behavior? Well, we think that rather than being risk takers, in some ways, adolescents are really risk averse. They avoid taking social risks. That is, they avoid the risk of being excluded by their social group. And why might this be? There's some evidence that adolescents are hypersensitive to being socially excluded. So none of us likes being excluded by our friends, but there's evidence that adolescents are particularly negatively affected by that. So because they are negatively affected by being socially excluded, they're driven to avoiding social risks, taking the risk of being excluded by their friends. So avoiding social risk might matter more to adolescents than avoiding other types of risks, like health risks. Here we have someone smoking, or legal risks, doing things you're not allowed to do. Now, using similar paradigms, we've also shown that adolescents, it's not just risk-taking where adolescents show this heightened propensity to be influenced by their friends. They also show heightened pro-social influence. What I mean by that is helping and giving behaviors such as charity donations. So adolescents are not only more influenced in negative ways like dangerous risk-taking, but also positive ways like giving money to charity. And the implication of this, I think, for public health and for education is that adolescents have a kind of power to influence each other, not only in negative ways, but also in positive, good, healthy ways. And indeed, you can see that in some studies that have looked at peer-led interventions and shown that peer-led interventions, so interventions in schools that are designed by and led by the students themselves, are more effective than adult-led interventions. So that has been shown in the context of, for example, anti-bullying interventions and also anti-smoking interventions. Okay, so in the next part of my talk, I'm going to very briefly talk about the development of the brain in adolescence. So we use MRI scanning to scan the living human brain. And with that, we can take very detailed images of the structure of the living human brain, also the function, but today I'm only going to be talking about the structure. We measure mostly gray matter in the cortex of the brain, the surface of the brain, and white matter in the middle of the brain. And I'll come back to that in a couple of slides' time. Okay, so just to say that when I was an undergraduate in the mid-90s, I was taught that the human brain stops developing in childhood. I know that because I remember my developmental neurobiology lectures, and I also kept my undergraduate textbooks, and that's exactly what they say. We now know, not such a long time afterwards, that that's completely false. And in fact, the human brain continues to develop right throughout childhood, right throughout adolescence and into early adulthood. And we know that because of many, many studies around the world using MRI, scanning children and adolescents longitudinally as they grow up. I'm going to give you one example of that. So this is a structural brain development study from four different cohorts of children and young people. This was led by Kate Mills, who's at Oregon, and Christian Tamnes at Oslo, and many other people who are listed here on one of the papers resulting from this study. Okay, the four cohorts, the four groups of people being scanned were from four different parts of the world. NIMH in Bethesda in the USA, Pittsburgh also in the USA, Leiden in the Netherlands, and Oslo in Norway. So completely different independent cohorts. Altogether, there were 391 participants, all of whom were scanned at some point between late childhood and early adulthood, several times as they grew up. So there were many, many changes, huge amounts of data from this research. I'm just going to show you, pick up on two of those. First of all, as David said in his talk, we see a very significant increase in cerebral white matter volume. So white matter is found in the center of the brain. It comprises these long fibers which connect up different brain regions together. And what you can see here is how it increases, that's the white matter on the vertical axis, across age. So as children grow up from age 5 to 30. And the pattern of development is remarkably similar in the four different cohorts. So this doesn't seem to depend on where you live. White matter volume increases by about 1% annually during adolescence. Cortical gray matter shows a different pattern. What you're going to see here is an average of gray matter across the whole cortex of the brain and what it does across age. It shows this non-linear pattern of development where it increases during early childhood, it's highest in late childhood, and then it undergoes this very substantial decline during adolescence. Gray matter volume decreases by about 1.5% annually during adolescence. And it doesn't do that across the whole cortex uniformly. The cortex develops at different rates, and I'm going to show you that in this little video here. This is a video showing how the brain changes between ages 4 and 21. And they've color-coded the gray matter to be more yellow when there's more gray matter and more blue when there's less gray matter. So as you go through your childhood and adolescence, the cortex, the surface of the brain here, loses a vast amount of gray matter. And the other thing that this video shows is that some regions, like the back of the brain, develop before other regions at the front of the brain. So for example, this region here at the front of the brain is called prefrontal cortex. It's one of the regions to develop latest in humans. And the prefrontal cortex is responsible for all sorts of high-level cognitive functions. And those cognitive functions, not surprisingly, also develop quite late and undergo lots of maturation during adolescence. And they include things like self-regulation, decision-making, planning, thinking about the future, self-awareness, creativity, exploration, all sorts of things, risk-taking, and social cognition, peer affiliation, and peer influence, as I've been talking about. Okay, so why does gray matter decrease and white matter increase during adolescence? What's going on at a cellular level? I'm only very briefly going to talk about this, but we think that both these patterns of brain development, at least in part associated with increased myelination and increased axonal growth. This is the axon that is attached to each neuronal cell body along which electrical impulses travel. And as you grow up, your axons in most parts of your brain increase in diameter and become myelinated, become coated in this fatty substance called myelin. And that increases the transmission of electrical impulses along the axon, making the brain work more quickly. And I'll just show you a very simple cartoon of that. So on the top, you see a myelinated axon with an electrical impulse zipping down it compared with an unmyelinated axon down here where the electrical impulse is much slower. So we know that myelination is continuing during adolescence. Axons are growing. There's also some synaptic reorganization during adolescence. So that, for example, these are the synapses, the gaps between neurons across which neurotransmitters are passed, and they undergo reorganization throughout childhood and adolescence. And all of those things together contribute, we think, to the gray matter decrease and the white matter increase during adolescence. Now, the important thing about all of these processes, myelination and the synaptic reorganization, is that they're partly dependent on the environment that the child is growing up in. For example, in terms of synapses, synapses that are being used in a particular environment are the ones that will remain in the brain, and synapses that are not being used in a particular environment are the ones that might become eliminated or, as we say, pruned away. So in that way, adolescence is characterized by heightened neuroplasticity. That is the way the brain adapts to its environment. And that can confer both opportunity for things like learning and rehabilitation, but also vulnerability, because some environments can be stressful. And we know that, for example, that mental health problems mostly first appear during adolescence. There are many examples of that, and recently there were a couple of very large-scale meta-analyses from around the world. This is just one example of them, which show exactly that. So this is a very large meta-analysis from 192 epidemiological studies from around the globe. And what this shows is the age of onset of various different mental health disorders, which are listed here. And what you can see is many of them first have their onset during this period of life, adolescence. The other thing about mental health problems in adolescence, which is kind of intriguing, is that they have increased in the past 15 years. The prevalence of mental health problems like depression and anxiety and eating disorders and self-harm have increased in prevalence in many different countries around the world in the last 10 or 15 years. This is just one example. So this shows the prevalence of depression in young people. This is a percentage of the population here. This happens to be from the US, but it could be plotted from almost any country in the world in the last 15 years. It's hugely increased. We don't know why. There are probably lots of explanations to this increase, but something else that has increased in the last 10 or 15 years is weekly internet use or social media use. Again, this is a graph showing weekly internet use in hours in young people. And many people have seen that kind of correlation and suggested that there's a link between increased social media use or internet use and lower mental health in adolescence, and have suggested that one causes the other. And that might be true to a certain extent, but I want to just emphasize here, this is in my last couple of minutes, that first of all, this relationship is really complicated. An example of how complicated it is that there's evidence that it's not just one way. So it's not just that people who use the internet more or social media more have more depression. The other direction is also true. So young people who are low or depressed or anxious might be more likely to use their phones more and use social media more because they're less likely to go out and interact with the world. But other things matter as well, like what are they looking at? The internet is really useful and very kind of productive and positive in many ways, but of course there are other websites that could be really damaging. But the research so far doesn't differentiate between that. It kind of lumps everything together. When are they looking at it? One trend I've noticed is that young people, you know, like to look at social media, we all do, but young people are so squeezed in their time during the day, going to school, homework, after school activities, that the only time, the only downtime they get to look at their phones is in the evening and perhaps going late into the night. And that, of course, disrupts their sleep, and we know that sleep is so crucial for brain development and learning and mental health and mood. How are they looking at it? There's some evidence that if people are engaging and interacting with their friends online, that's quite good for them. Whereas there's some evidence that just passively scrolling through other people's social media feeds might be less positive. And finally, individual differences. And this is what I'm going to talk about in my last data slide. Until recently, no one had really looked at how social media affects well-being or mood at different ages. They just combined age groups together, and they hadn't looked at gender differences. And that's what we've been doing recently with my colleague, Amy Auburn, who's at Cambridge, and she's world-renowned for her research in this area. So this was a study where we looked at the longitudinal relationship between social media use and life satisfaction in young people. We capitalized upon this very, very large survey called the UK Understanding Society Database. So this is British young people, over 17,000 participants, aged 10 to 21. There were 9 testing waves. So each person was tested 9 times as they grew up. And they were asked to estimate their social media use each day or each week. And they were also asked about their life satisfaction, how happy they were. And what we were interested in is this question here. Does increased social media use in 1 year predict a drop in life satisfaction the following year for each individual? Are there differences between ages within this age range and between genders? And I'm going to show you the data. So what you see here is, this is the data for the males only. So this is the relationship between social media use and life satisfaction in males aged between 10 and 20. What you can see, interestingly, is most of the time there is zero relationship. That's this zero bar here. There's no correlation, there's no relationship between social media use 1 year and life satisfaction the following year. However, that is not true at 2 ages for males. Between age 13 to 15 or 14-15 here, there's a drop. What that means is that at that age, 14 to 15, more social media use 1 year predicts lower life satisfaction the following year. And that's also true again at age 19 for males. We found exactly the same for females, except this time the dip happens earlier between ages 11 and 13, the dip in early adolescence. But again, exactly the same age at age 19 for females. What we think is going on here is that puberty is very disruptive in many ways. Puberty happens a couple of years earlier on average for girls than for boys. Puberty disrupts your social life. Suddenly you're looking different, you feel different, you have to make new social networks. And that might drive you to look at your phone more, and that's not always positive for some people. And what's happening at age 19, this is all very speculative, but we think, well, 19 is the age when most people live independently for the first time. So that, again, will drive them to have to make new social networks, new friends, which might lead them to use their social media more on their phones, and that's not always positive for all young people. So some age groups are particularly vulnerable to the effects of social media. So just to summarize, adolescents avoid social risk, the risk of being socially excluded, and this can drive some of their behavior. Peer influence is heightened, but it can be positive. Adolescents can encourage each other to make positive, healthy decisions. The brain develops very, very substantially throughout adolescence. And in fact, we now think about adolescence as a sensitive period of brain development, which confers both vulnerability to things like mental health problems, but also opportunity for learning and creativity. And finally, social media use is associated with a decrease in well-being at certain vulnerable points during adolescence. So thank you for listening to me, and thank you to my research group and my funders.